الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له أشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى إلى كافة الناس بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا أما بعد الحمد لله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. It's my honor and pleasure to be amongst you today, mashallah. It's a wonderful opportunity, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give barakah and ajr to our host for hosting this event, mashallah. We make dua for all of us on here, and we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspires us to speak the truth and to understand the truth for what it is, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ni'mah on this ummah is eternal, and it is also perpetual, and it is everlasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fadl on us comes through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as you know, is rahmatul lil alameen. He is a rahmah, he is a means of mercy for all the worlds that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. And this is what the Quran says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. We have not sent you except a means of rahmah for all the worlds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Rabbul Alameen, He is the Lord of the world. And Rasulullah is Rahmatul Lil Alameen, He is a rahmah for all the worlds. And this makes up the code of Islam, which is La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah. So when we are discussing Aqidah, we must appreciate the first code and the first kalima of Islam, which is La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. So as we try and speak today, inshallah, and develop this rapport and understand what Aqidah is and what Aqidah is not, we must appreciate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides us through human beings. What is the most important now channel and means by which Allah guides people? It is the human channel. So if someone was to say that I'm guided by God through my subjective experience, or through dreams, or through inspirations, or through lyrics, or through the arts, or observation, then we will say this is an incomplete means of guidance. What is the most perfect way of guidance? Guidance through another human being. Guidance through another human being. That is the challenge for Muslims of today, to express the guidance that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave to all the worlds as a human being. And this challenge is not new, because the Quraysh and people before the Quraysh, when they dealt with the messengers of Allah, they always used to undermine the institution of the human being. And they would say, Mali hadha rasul ya'kulu at-ta'am wa yamshi fil aswaq, that what is with this human and this messenger, that he is walking through the streets and the bazaar and the souq, and he's eating food. So if there was divine guidance, then there should be a divine channel and means by which the divine guides. So people who rejected the deen and wahi and revelation, they made this excuse that we don't want to follow any other human being. In huwa illa rajulun, the kuffar of previous times used to say, he's only a man. So how can a man claim that he has divine guidance? And how can a man say that he is a means of guidance to all other human beings? So we as Muslims have been blessed with the ni'mah of Islam and guidance through Rasulullah. And who is Rasulullah? His name is Muhammad ibn Abdullah. Muhammad, the son of Abdullah. He is human. He is not divine. Once we appreciate this, then we can talk about Aqidah. But if any person does not appreciate the humanness in Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then you cannot speak about Aqidah, because this is the fulcrum. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the fulcrum. Let me give you an example. If someone says that I believe in the oneness of God, but does not believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a messenger of God, then he may be a monotheist, but he's not a Muslim. You agree with this? Somebody here in Dubai says, I believe in the oneness of God, but I don't want to believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a messenger of God, then we will say that he is a person of Tawheed, but he is not Muslim. So what does it take to become a Muslim? To believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the last messenger. So this means that our acceptance of deen and revelation is wahi based, but on top of a Nabi, a Rasul who is human. So our deen is human based, and the Rasul's deen is wahi based. So wahi doesn't come to us. Wahi comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we say Muhammad Rasulullah, we establish two things. One is that Muhammad is human, and the second is that he receives wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he represents Allah in the human society. And the Quran says in every society, every community, wherever there is creation, Muhammad is Rasulullah. So the jinn came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and accepted Islam. They accepted the Quran. So he is a Rasul for whom? The jinn. The angels, they all accept Muhammad as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whichever world and plane of existence you will encounter in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's cosmos and creation, wherever, every one will declare that Muhammad is Rasulullah. At the same time, everyone will also acknowledge that Muhammad is human. Muhammad is not divine. So divinity does not creep into the human being, and the human being does not become divine. So we separate La ilaha illallah from Muhammad Rasulullah, but in that separation there is unity. In that separation there is unity. So Allah is divine, and Muhammad is divinely entrusted. Muhammad is divinely entrusted to do what? To represent God in the human society, so that human beings know that this is a person that if we believe in him and trust him, he will guide us and he will show us the right way towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and especially in matters of ibadat, and especially in matters of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So before we discuss aqidah in Islam, this is the foundational premise that Muhammad is human. Muhammad is a representative of God. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam And the Quran is Allah's word, and Muhammad is the explanation of that word. This is the foundation for our Aqidah. Everybody agree on this? Nobody disagrees? Is there any question? Do you foresee any question coming from somebody? How would that be?
The people that don't accept Muhammad, they're going to ask a lot of questions.
Yeah, but we're not speaking to them. We're speaking to whom? Those who accept Muhammad as Rasulullah. What I'm saying is that you can only speak about Islamic theology and Aqidah to whom? To Muslims. You can only speak about Aqidah to whom? The Muslim. That is a foundational, what we call a theistic prerequisite for the discussion. Right. So once you acknowledge and once you submit to Allah and His Rasul, then you can speak about Islam. Before you explain Islam, you have to get to this point first. So now, what is the da'wah? The da'wah is to do what? Bring people to Allah and to His Rasul. That is the da'wah. The da'wah is not to explain the theological nuances to a non-Muslim. Why are you wasting your time? The theological nuances and the beauty of Islam is for whom? For the Muslims. It is not for the non-Muslim. You can paint a rosy picture, mashallah, right, that you have here. This Palm Jumeirah, mashallah, it's a wonderful place. And you have a brochure all the way there in Chicago, right? In December, January, when it's snowing, there's a blizzard, and somebody sees a picture of Palm Jumeirah. This is wonderful. But it won't make any sense until when he comes here. So the beauty of Palm Jumeirah is for the one who comes here. It's not for the one who looks at the brochure. So the da'wah is to bring people to La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. Then the explanation of the Aqidah is for Muslims. So we see this as necessary so that Muslims do not confuse the idea of da'wah with ta'lim. Da'wah with Ta'lim. Ta'lim means to learn, to understand. You understand after the fact. You don't understand before the fact. For instance, when we pray, coming into the five pillars where we discuss now, Aqidah through the five pillars. When we pray, when we do our salat and we say Allahu Akbar for the first time in our lives, Alhamdulillah, mashallah, do we understand everything there is to understand about salat? No. Are we required to? No. We're not required. What are we required to do? We're required to perform. And we're required to follow the Prophet ﷺ in that method of salat. That is what makes us Muslim. Okay. So likewise, a person who wants to give da'wah to non-Muslims, he should not be obligated with the task of trying to explain all the nice things about Islam and the beauty of Islam to and a Muslim, except from that universal level and that universal platform that, look, this religion is the religion of truth for several reasons. One reason is that it is historically the only religion. It is the only religion. Every other religion was what? A deviation from this religion. This is our Aqidah as Muslims, is that true? What was the religion of Adam? Islam. What is the religion of Ibrahim? What is the religion of Musa and Isa? Islam. So Islam is not a new kid on the block. Islam is the gatekeeper. We're not new to human civilization. And this is what the Quran says to Rasulullah ﷺ, قُلْ مَا كُنْتُ بِدَعًا مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. Say, I am not new as a messenger. I am the last chain in a long chain of messengers that came from Adam until me. So I'm not new. So when Muslims represent Islam to non-Muslims, they must have an international platform upon which they express their Islam. And they must have an international message that shows everybody else in the world that Islam is not new to human civilization. Every other deen came as a result of distortion or deviation from Islam. Why is this necessary when we speak about Aqidah? So that we don't become confused or enamored with a multi-faith religion, a universal religion, pluralism. The people say there's one universal religion and everybody now, they have the prerogative to worship God the way they want to because everything is good. Okay, this absolute relativism that has taken over the world today. Okay, so we need to be careful that we do not mention any Aqidah of Islam as being new or as being exclusive to Muslims who came with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So what is my point? My point is that Aqidah is something that comes from Wahi, and Wahi is eternal. Wahi is timeless. Any Aqidah that came to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it is necessary for our Najat, came to all the other prophets before him. All the other prophets before him. So this is something that we must appreciate. So when we are representing, discussing Islam to non-Muslims, we must have this mindset and this confidence, because it is the truth that Islam is not new. More than often, when Muslims are with Christians and Jews, they say that Islam came third. Why? Because historically, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came when?
Last.
After Musa and after Isa, we say no. That is not true. Because we say Musa and Isa were both Muslim. We say Musa and Isa both predicted and prophesied what? The coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the last messenger which the Quran speaks of. So we must be careful how we represent Islam in this new wave, in this new culture, as being something new. So we say, no, Islam is not new. Islam came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it came from Wahi. Wahi is eternal. So whatever knowledge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about Najat, salvation, and the Akhirah, he gave to all prophets before him. And this is the meaning of the ayah, لَا نُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ أَحَدٍ مِّن رُسُولِهِ. We do not differentiate amongst any of his messengers. Why? Because the message for salvation was the same. It was uniform and it was universal. It was not something that was unique to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he came up with a new deen, a new religion, which was theology and which was aqidah. Now, the practice of Islam, meaning some of the details of Salat, and the details of Sawm, and the details of Zakat and Hajj, they have changed. But that is called Sharia. That is called what?
Sharia.
Sharia. That is the practice of Islam that changes with a Nabi or Rasul as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deemed it necessary or relevant. But what is not changing and not changeable is the Aqidah, the theology. And what is theology in Islam, Aqidah? It has now three components. One is Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other is Risalah, which is prophethood. And the other is Akhirah, which is the hereafter. In these three, nothing has changed. Nothing has changed since Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. We believe in the same. So when we are representing Islam in front of non-Muslims, we must put forward first the universal platform. Universal not in only in times of eternity, but also in times of history. So in the historical context, we must appreciate Adam, and then Nuh, and then Ibrahim, Musa, and Isa, and they were all Muslim in the same way we are Muslim So Islam is not a new religion. Islam is the only religion and the oldest religion. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this throughout the Quran, and the Prophet subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this throughout the Sunnah, that this is how Muslims must believe and must think. And what is now the benefit of this? The benefit of this is that we do not become now exclusivists. You had a question, yeah?
You mentioned religion on a number of occasions in reference to Islam, and for clarity,
yes.
Okay, making sure when we're talking to new Muslims or
yeah.
non-Muslims, okay, when you use the word religion,
yeah.
okay, I wanted to be clear in terms of the difference between religion, the word religion, and deen.
Yes, yes.
And if we should be representing, if we're going to represent Islam
yes.
as deen,
yes.
what, deen or religion, because
yeah.
they're
no.
not the same.
So, you can argue about the semantics, but effectively it's the same. I mean, what is your perception of religion? When you speak to somebody out in the West, their perception of religion
yeah.
is very close to our perception of deen. So, I mean, you can argue and discuss the semantics, but whichever works in the locality that you live in,
mm-hmm.
you can use that word and terminology. There's no harm in that.
Okay.
Deen is very comprehensive, and we'll speak about that in a second session.
And if we can keep all the questions to the end of the first session, and then we'll have a question and answers, and then one at the end of the second session as well, we can write down the questions.
Yes, but this is something we'll hopefully speak of in the second session. So we understand this framework now. The framework is that Islam is the only religion, it is the universal religion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expressed and gave to all the Prophets alayhi wa sallam. They all received wahi and revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they all gave their community these basic aqaid, tawheed, risala, and akhirah. They all spoke of Jannah, they all spoke of Jahannam, they all warned their people about Dajjal, as the Prophet said, and they all prophesied the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is universal. So we must not be shy to say this, because this is Aqidah. Now, the second point is, how do you prove this? For that, you have to do some research. For that, you need scholarships. For that, you need to go to schools and institutions. That's a separate discussion. But this is Aqidah. We as Muslims must believe this. And the Sahaba, when they went out with this Aqidah. That's why they were very, very aggressive in their articulation of Islam. They did not feel at all embarrassed or shy to tell anybody on the planet that this is the only deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to practice in the deen, in the Allah Islam. They weren't shy to say that. Nowadays, we make what? Concessions. We feel that we have to make concessions. Allah. Depends who you are. And if you're in the game of interfaith, and if you're in the game of da'wah, then you can't be making concessions. You have to say it the way it is. Lakum deenukum waliya deen. You have your deen, and I have my deen. Period. Meaning that there's no crossover. There's no what? No crossover. We also believe in Jesus is an apologetic statement which has very severe consequences on the psyche of not only the person saying that, but also the person receiving that. We also believe in Jesus means you've conceded. Oh, your understanding of Jesus is the same as ours. We also believe in Jesus. No, we don't. Do we believe in Jesus the way they do? No. So you can't say we also believe in Jesus, because they believe in Jesus in a very different way. And we believe in Jesus because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said we should. Again, wahi came to whom?
The Prophet.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when we say we follow the Quran, they say, okay, did the Quran come to you? No. The Quran came to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we believe in the Quran the way Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that we should believe in the Quran. So when the Quran speaks about Isa, we must ascertain what Rasulullah understood from that. And who transmitted that? The Sahaba. So we must ascertain what the Sahaba understood from that. And who is going to do that? The Tabi. So now you have this chain, you have this sanad, you have this silsila going back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so that deen is now understood through the human chain and not through the abstract imagination, not through hallucination, and not through fantasizing. Oh, the Quran has this ayah, Allah, what I'm going to spend now the next 5 hours just being in the ocean of this ayah. That's not the way. How do you do it? You spend time with somebody who knows what the Tabi'een said about this ayah, what the Sahaba said about this ayah, and then what Rasulullah said about this ayah. Those 5 hours with a human being, they'll be much more valuable than what? Fantasizing about the ayah. Well, maybe the ayah means this. Maybe the ayah means this. Because you don't have a freehold over what? Any ayah of the Quran. Wahi didn't come to you. Wahi came through the human chain. So we must establish that the human chain of understanding wahi is the key to our najat, the key to our salvation. Yeah. Now within the parameters of the human chain, there's a lot of room for understanding the Quran and Sunnah, meaning that the scholars did not restrict anyone from trying to understand the Quran after they've understood the parameters. Within these parameters, so that you remain within an Islamic framework and you don't go into a non-Islamic framework or an un-Islamic framework. Why is this important? For instance, let me say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to fast in the Ramadan. And when He tells us to fast, we must also break fast the way that Allah tells us to. Is that true? But where is that method written? Where is the word in the Quran that tells us we must break our fast? It's not there. Didn't say that. Now, if somebody comes up to you and says, look, the Muslims have invented extra Quranic terminology to understand the Quran and deen, and therefore Muslims must go back to the Quran and understand the deen directly from
Quran.
The Quran. Now this framework is false. Is that true? Where is it written that Maghrib is 3 rakats in the Quran?
Nowhere.
Did it say so? But why do you do 3 rakats in Maghrib for? Because it is what Muslims do. It is how Muslims have always understood the hukum of aqimus salah, establish salat. So now how have Muslims understood divine wahi? Through the human chain, through human society, through human communication, not through spiritual communication, not through angels. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu took on the task of now leading the ummah, did he claim that he has access to wahi? When Umar became the Khalifa, did he say, I have now another understanding of the Quran which Abu Bakr didn't have or Rasulullah did not have? No. So understanding that the wahi then must be contextualized according to the framework of those human beings who understood wahi from Rasulullah directly. And if that is not established, then you will be committing many, many forms of bid'at, innovations that will be exceptionally horrible. And because of this now freelance understanding of Islam, we unfortunately in the 20th century have committed the most obnoxious forms of intellectual bid'at that are unheard of in previous centuries. When you give license to a person who says that because I know Arabic, I can understand the Quran, then what have you done? What have you produced? What has the 20th century produced? This turmoil, torture, terrorism. This is all on the back of this framework that I don't need to understand the Quran through a human. No, we're not saying every human being is a framework. We are saying who is the framework? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Sahaba, and the Tabi'in. They were the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now Aqidah is going to be guided by whom? By these three generations. The generation that was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the generation that came after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the generation that came afterwards. Now within that framework, there's huge, huge vastness. The problem with the modern day Muslim is that the modern day Muslim assumes that Islam is restrictive if you go to the Sahaba and the Tabi'in, whereas that is not the case. The ordinary scholar of deen will realize as soon as he picks up the understanding of the Quran Hadith through tafasir and books of Hadith that Islam is so vast. Islam is so what? Vast. Now, this vastness doesn't mean to say that the early scholars and the early Tabi'un, they destroyed the framework of Islam. So we must now differentiate between what is allowed and what is not allowed. Where can you differ and where can you not differ? So you cannot differ on primary issues of Aqidah that every Muslim believed in. So in that sense, Islam is monolithic, where every Muslim had the same deen, had the same religion, had the same understanding of who is Allah, who is the Rasul, and what is the Akhirah. That's called monolithic. That is what? Then people differed and they discussed, and so on and so forth. So now, to give you an example, if you are understanding Islam as an Aqidah first, your theology first, and your basic Aqaid first, and then on top of that, on the back of that, you have actions, then you are safe. But if you understand Islam as actions first and Aqidah second, then you're not safe. How come? For instance, somebody drinks. It's a sin. It is haram. Drinking is haram. We're not saying it's haram. But somebody drinks as a Muslim, right? As a Muslim, he's drinking. But he believes that drinking is haram. Is he still Muslim? Yes. Meaning there's room for his tawbah and forgiveness. He's a sinner, but he's still a Muslim. But if someone doesn't drink and says drinking is wrong, and science has proven that drinking is wrong, and society is disrupted and destroyed because of drinking and gambling, and he brings in the utilitarian approach to drinking, and he then concludes that since this is destructive and detrimental to human society, I'm not going to drink, but I believe that drinking is halal. Is he a Muslim?
No.
No. Why? Because he believes what? Drinking is halal. So now what have you done? We are saying that actions come upon Aqidah. Aqidah does not come upon actions. This is called the Sunnah. This is called the way of the Sahaba. This is called the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is called the way of the Tabi'un. That they all understood Islam as being primarily your Aqidah. Your deen is your Aqidah. What do you believe about this? What is your world view about this? Is drinking halal or haram? It is haram. If you drink, then you are committing a sin. And if you don't drink, then that is good. And it will be, inshallah, towards your salvation. But if you believe for an instant that drinking is halal, but I don't drink because it will cause me to fight with my wife and I'll slap her. There's this is un-Islamic, this is unacceptable. That person's a kafir. He has to renew his shahada. So Aqidah comes first, and action comes second. So what is that definition of Muslim? The definition of a Muslim is someone who believes correctly. Someone who believes? Correctly. What is your belief system? What is your faith system? This is our faith system, this is our belief system. So that must be ascertained first, and this is what Rasulullah concentrated on in Mecca for 13 years, and after that was established, then you can say, now let's bring on the ahkam, let's bring on the actions, let's bring on everything else so that it will be applied on the back of a theology. You cannot express religion if there is no theology. Meaning the universal sense of good behavior and morality which has now seeped through even the Muslim mind today, that Muslims have to be morally good. Even though the Aqidah may be wrong, that is a distorted approach. Now, I'm not suggesting for a second that we should behave immorally. I'm just saying that we must get the framework right first. If the framework is right, and the philosophy is right, and the approach is right, and the lens by which you see the world is correct, then you will create people who will do many good things. But if the framework is wrong, and you want to do good things, then that will not be Islamic. For instance, many people come to us in the States, and they say, this person is such a good Muslim, because he does this, this, and that. So our first question to him is usually, what does he believe in about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Does he believe in Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger, or does he believe that wahi comes to him also? How do people believe that wahi comes to him? By not ascertaining the correct human link to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Well, I have thought of this idea myself. For instance, I'll give you an example. I'm being recorded here. Right. Muslims in Ramadan, they have this desire to express to their neighbors and the community that we fast. Wonderful, alhamdulillah, desire. Beautiful. And we want to show our colleagues and co-workers that we fast. So what do Muslims do? They say that we must now somehow encourage our non-Muslim colleagues to fast with us. So now what are you doing? What have you done? You are saying that it is binding upon a non-Muslim to fast. And you are saying that if a non-Muslim fasts, Allah will reward him for fasting. Isn't that what you're saying? That's the true meaning of interfaith. Let's do our religious acts together. We must come together. But the Quran says, no, لا عبود ما تعبدون. I don't worship what you worship. So why are you putting the poor neighbor into this excruciating thirst and hunger because you want to show that you fast? That borders on masochism. You want him to suffer. And you want to feel the pain and the hunger. Better than that, what you should do is that when you break your fast, mashallah, you should invite him to the table and say, we have just fasted, we want to share the food with you, let's break bread together. That will be much more appropriate than telling the poor guy to stay away from food and drink the whole day. Because in that process, you have changed the aqidah. What is the aqidah? That a non-Muslim, if he fasts, he'll also be welcome. You say, no. Islam is a prerequisite for what? All actions. A non-Muslim cannot pray, period, the way we do. A non-Muslim cannot give zakat the way we do. A non-Muslim cannot fast the way we do. Islam is the exclusive behavior and privilege of a Muslim. That is why in our history we never imposed Islamic acts upon the non-Muslim communities. And the people who want people to fast, they have this also as their evidence in other scenarios and other settings, that Muslims were so, mashallah, tolerant that they never did not oppress non-Muslims, and we gave non-Muslims their civil rights, which is true. We had the Dhimmi laws, right? We had Jews and Christians living in Muslim Spain and everywhere else that Muslims were, and they enjoyed a very good life. But was there anywhere in Muslim history, in Mughal India, where the Muslims forced Islamic acts and rituals upon non-Muslims? That every time Ramadan came, did the Mughals say to the Hindus, you can't eat because we're fasting. Let's share our religion. Was there any instance in Muslim Spain where the Muslim Khalifa announced, hey, we're fasting, so you can't eat or drink? No. Why? Because they knew that their religion is different from ours. Exposing our religion to them doesn't mean to say that you tell them to fast, or you tell them to pray, or you tell them to give zakat, or you tell them let's go fast. You can't go fast anyway. Right? So I'm saying, this framework, what is the framework? The framework is that Islam is based on Aqidah first, and action second. Islam is not based on action first and Aqidah second. The framework must be right. Once we establish this, then inshallah, we can talk about Islam and we can talk about Aqidah. But if we do not appreciate this, then we will be facing ourselves, confronting ourselves with so many different problems that are unspeakable. This is one of the dilemmas we have in the good old USA, mashallah, where there is absolute relativism. Because fasting is good, we should share this goodness with everybody. But that doesn't work. Rasulullah did not come to force people to do something that they did not accept themselves. La ikraha fid din. There's no compulsion in religion. There's no compulsion. Meaning that if you don't accept Islam, then don't do it. You will face the consequences. That's up to Allah when you meet Him. But we're not going to force Him. So we gave non-Muslims their civil rights and their freedom to practice their deen the way they wanted to without enforcing any Islamic ritual upon anyone. And this was the beauty of understanding Islam through the lens of Aqidah. This is our worldview. We are Muslim, you are non-Muslim, period. There is a separation. You cannot cross over. If you cross over, you'll be developing many, many forms of conscious complexes where people will become so mild and so diluted in their understanding of Islam that nobody will know what Islam is. So we have to protect the deen from this dilution. And this is why the story of Aqidah is very necessary for us to begin with. That is where Islam begins. It doesn't end there. And with this said, inshallah, we'll open the floor for questions and discussion and comments, inshallah.
Surah to Asr, the Quran, Allah says those four things that that all mankind is lost except to do those four things. That first thing is Amilu Salihat, which is Iman. Now, so many scholars have said that that actions are based upon Iman. Coming from that, Iladina Aminu first Iman, then actions, then is this similar in Aqidah? Because Aqidah is based upon also upon belief.
Yes.
That, so that the iman, actions are based upon iman, which means that actions should also be based upon Aqidah. Not Aqidah based upon actions. Actions come before Aqidah. It's just a similar type of explanation.
Iman comes first, then.
Of course.
Yeah.
Iman is first.
The iman is your Aqidah.
Yeah, iman is your Aqidah.
Then your actions.
Absolutely.
So your actions are a translation of your iman.
Yes. Sorry. That's it.
Yep. I have one question.
No.
Like in your introductory talk, you said Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a human being. So can we add that he is a super great human being or just
human? He is a human being who receives wahi.
So he's great, is above ordinary human being. I mean.
No doubt. He was already an exceptional human being before wahi.
Before wahi also.
He was the best human being before wahi. Right? What did wahi do? It added value to his excellence.
Yes.
So you don't want to say he was a superhuman being.
Can you expand on what is wahi?
Wahi is the ability to receive Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's word, his kalam. That takes not just only good character and moral values, but also it takes a very unique level of intellectual abilities, very broad intellectual abilities. So what wahi does, it expands your intellect. But the intellect must be based on good behavior. So it's in that order. So every Nabi, as we discussed, every Nabi has a good moral character before wahi. No Nabi is tarnished with any flaw. There's no defect in any Nabi's behavior. Once that's established, then the intellectual side of the Nabi is developed, which then opens the door for wahi. So wahi is now beyond any ordinary human being's intellect. Now,
I want to talk to you about a couple of things. One has to do with the idea about Aqidah in terms of the way you articulate it. I think it's very important for us to understand in terms of Islam being the religion, it is the first of all religion.
Yes.
Now, and you said something about perennialists as well as the interfaith community. What I realize as I'm listening to you talk about this is that often perennialists, including Nasser, you know,
yes,
and these other perennialists, who try to see commonalities / divinities within the other religious traditions, building collaborations and partnership. Now, for the most part, most of the perennialists that I've read and studied really are clear on their aqidah, but I think what has happened is, over the years, including the interfaith community, with the constant conflict between the East and the West, between Islam and the Western world, there has been a tendency of people to try to build bridges.
Yes.
And the idea of building bridges often can, as you were saying, and I think you cautioned us properly, that we can often in interfaith dialogue and the dialogic process compromise our articulation in terms of the strictness and the clarity of Aqidah in terms of Islam.
Yes.
However, I think strategically, for the practical purpose of building relationships, Udu fi sabili rabbika bil hikma wa mawdhil hasana, often Muslims tend to try to build relationships that don't demonize other religions, that say within your tradition, strategically in our conversation, if we are to have a decent conversation, then we do recognize that your faith is your faith and that's what you've chosen, and it is one of the monotheistic traditions. So how do you now balance that? And the final thing is around the issue of people fasting. I know here, for example, the people at NYU Abu Dhabi, first time being in a Muslim country, first time being introduced to Islam and being around Muslims, decided to fast, not because a Muslim says you should fast, but decided to fast in a sense of trying to identify solidarity and cultural awareness, because as you know, the idea of an essentialist approach to Islam often alienates people from a sense of collectivity. In terms of multiculturalism, a diversity in globalization, increase an environment where we have to now live in societies where people have multiplicities of beliefs. So we as Muslims who are really trying to deal with hikmah often take positions that, well, we want to find commonality, build bridges, because what often I find the people in Dawah, and particularly in the interfaith communities, they have an agenda, and the agenda is really to preach, to really make them accept Islam, explain to Islam. It's Dawah, as you were saying about the issue of Dawah.
Yeah.
So how do you balance that without coming out so essentialist in terms of your public discourse that alienates, as opposed to creating a kind of lexicon or language that allows for communication that is embracing and reflective of the multi-religious, multi-ethnic world that we live in.
Good. These are important questions. Though those are more related to policy than what you call Aqidah, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this would be for any government to decide what is their policy vis-a-vis the expression of Islam in their state. But there again, you still have to maintain that when you're training the trainer, you must establish the premise that this is your Aqidah.
Yeah, I like it.
Yeah. So for the sake of coexistence, we won't go out on a limb. And these people who want, in the States, others to fast, we don't go out on the limb or from the member, saying that what you are doing is destroying the essentialness of Islam. We don't say that. We're just saying that come to the classroom first and understand what it is your Aqidah. Once you've understood your Aqidah, then as a matter of policy, you may then discuss. And then diversify your approach, which is known as hikmah. So we don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
I mean, that's the way forward. If there are some common values, as you say about the pluralist, the common values are there, but the question for the da'i or for the academic is that where did those common values come from?
True.
Okay. Are those common values only dictated by sharia for the Muslim, meaning that the value of what is good and what is evil, husn and qubr, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there you need to discuss academically that which camp says what. What do the Mu'tazili say? What do the Ash'ari say? What do the Maturidi say? So that's the course itself. So they had their premises and each one different on different issues. So the universality of good and evil, okay, that's a discussion in of itself. But for a Muslim to adhere to the idea that we have commonalities with other religions is a concession.
I like the concept,
yeah.
And I've grappled with this for many years around the idea of listening to interfaith dialogue and being involved in interfaith dialogue,
yes.
And then often hearing Muslims, very rarely hearing the purity of the notion of Aqidah in terms,
yes,
of Muslims really believe, although we're dialogue with Christians, but we really believe that there's one deen.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly.
Islam is the only deen, really.
Yes.
But of course, in a dialogical situation, you can't say, well, as a Buddhist, you don't exist, or you're nothing, you know, we don't recognize it.
Mm.
You see?
That's right. Well, it's in Surah Fatiha, Ghayr al-Maghdubi alayhim wal-Dhaaleen, the two types of people that you don't want to become, and those who, you know, incurred the wrath of Allah, and those who deviated. So meaning that everyone deviated. Dalala means what? Deviation. From where did they deviate? They deviated from the right path. So there was one right path. There can only be one right path towards Allah, towards the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So bringing these commonalities for the sake of coexistence and for political coexistence or social or cultural coexistence, that's fine, that's a matter of policy. That's not a matter of deen or qidah. And that's where many Muslims are very confused, especially in the States, where everybody wants to interfaith and dialogue and says we must be good in this kind of areas. I'll give you an example. My key line is that make sure the fiqh is right.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever it is, make sure the fiqh is right. That when you're saying that your neighbor who's a Christian or a Jew is wrong, then how do you behave with him or her?
Mm-hmm.
What is your behavior? So you behave the way the Prophet ﷺ said you should.
Right.
So why are you kind to your neighbor? It is because of your deen, not because your neighbor's good. Well, if your neighbor's bad, are you still obligated to be good to him?
Yes.
Is that it? So one is a concession. Oh, my neighbor's so nice, so I should reciprocate. That to me is a cop-out.
Yep.
I'm good to my neighbor because I'm following Rasulullah.
Mm.
It is a sunnah, it is my deen, it is who I am, it is what I do, it is what I believe. So that is much more, shall we say, Muslim.
Mm-hmm.
And then going the other way, they're so nice and they say hello to me when
mm-hmm.
I open the door and they open the door, mashallah. So I have to say hello to them, reciprocate, and have tea together, which is wonderful, you can do that. But what's the premise? What is your aqidah? What is your worldview? What is your lens by which you look at it? So it might seem to some people that it's condescending, but it's not. Because when you behave and you're representing Rasulullah, you are giving the best da'wah. The best da'wah is to follow Rasulullah. So my line is, get the fiqh right. What does the fiqh say about this issue, about this occasion, this instance? So now that's where understanding the fiqh and sharia becomes paramount also. But yes, to your point, we should be more inclusive in our policies, because that's the only way any country in the world is going to survive. If you don't have this policy within your own land, then how are you going to survive with the international borders around you?
Mm-hmm.
If you're very, very, very kind of condescending and in your face kind of approach in your own land, and you don't want to tolerate anybody in your own land, the neighbors around you will say, we're not going to do any deals with you, we're going to impose sanctions on you, and so on. So I think in international relationships, that policy issue becomes very fundamental. And this was the beauty of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina, that he told the Sahaba, be kind to your neighbors. And the demographics of Medina have us believe what? Most of those neighbors are whom? They're Jews. They're all Jews, most of them.
And to the point of this neighbor issue and being good to them regardless of their behavior, isn't there an example of one of the Prophet's neighbors dumping trash was in front of his house almost on a daily basis?
Yes. Yes.
And that's not an example of a good neighbor, but nonetheless, he treated him kindly. And
Yes. I mean, you are, when Allah says you have to be kind and generous and good, then you are that. And when Allah says, you know, you've got to toughen up and take on the challenge, then you have to be that also. So the fiqh has to be right. So when the fiqh allows it, then you do it. When the fiqh doesn't allow it, then you don't do it. So we're not allowed by fiqh to now attack the idols of polytheists. Right? The Quran says, وَلَا تَصُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Then don't swear at those who worship others besides Allah. That is the fiqh of this. Now, that doesn't mean to say that we tell them, hey, we're not allowed to swear to idols, that means you're okay. They're not okay, because shirk is what? Unforgivable sin. But because it's unforgivable sin, doesn't give you the license to say what? Your idols are filthy and dirty. That's where the balance comes in. It's very nuanced, and it's very tricky, because the emotions obviously take over. Muslims lived in India for centuries. They never went around destroying all the idols in India. They're still there. They're not very pretty, but they're still there.
Shaykh, I mean, to the other point about the Prophet ﷺ being human, is it safe for us to say that the Prophet ﷺ was a human like a diamond is a rock? In other words, you know, it's in the category or family of human or rock, but a diamond is something rare and special and
you can
different.
It's elementary, but you can. Give a bit more organic life than a diamond and rock.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Interact with them and listen to them, but I understand that I should still consider them as Muslims because they believe in Allah, I don't know Muhammad and Rasulullah. So this is a confusing.
Yes. Well, that is where the Aqidah is necessary. That they are still Muslim, they are sinners, they are wrong, and Allah still has the prerogative to forgive them if He wants. But they are sinners and they are not following the Sunnah. They're not following the Prophet. But it's not as if every other religion in the world has ideal citizens, mashallah, and subjects and followers. Right? You cannot consider them as non-Muslims. So that the enemies of Islam means that they are not Muslim. You can't say that. They are definitely destroying the image of Islam. You can say that. They're distorting the image of Islam. They're not representing Islam properly or correctly. But they're still Muslim. Yeah.
So this point came up recently in the States and in the UK, some recent incidents, where members of the Muslim community actually went ahead and said that these people, these are not the acts of Muslims, so we don't see these people as Muslims. This was said by various communities. So
yes,
that was...
Well, that's exactly the way it is then. Islam is based on aqidah, not on action. So it is conceivable and real that a Muslim may commit sin. And the problem with this approach is that Muslims want every other Muslim to be Puritan. So we become purists. We have not acknowledged the reality that human beings will be what? Human beings. And that is why the humanness of Rasulullah is foundational. You must accept that. As human beings, you will make mistakes. Not the Prophet, he didn't make mistakes. But as human beings, you will commit sin. And as human beings, you will become evil. Right? Isn't that true? Yeah. So now you bring everybody together on the human platform and say, look, whether you are Jews or Christians or Hindus or Buddhists or Muslims, you will commit atrocities. And that's a historical fact. Right? People after 9/11, they made statements saying that how come all Muslims are violent? So Islam must be a violent religion because all Muslims are violent. And many of those people in the audiences, in the churches, were at the same time trying to learn about Buddhism. So I said, do you know who the Buddhists are? Said, yes, the Buddhists are peaceful people. Said, okay, why don't you go and ask the people of Burma, the Muslims who have been slaughtered day in, day out, where the Buddhists are, and they're very good people or they're violent people. So there's no answer. What is the historical fact is that Christians and Jews and other people of different religions have always committed atrocities. The whole North American experience, the two world wars, they weren't initiated by violent Muslims. So are you saying that the violence is now exclusive to whom? Muslims? That's crazy. Yeah. So if you appreciate that human beings will always be human beings, and it is up to the human being to follow the precepts and the commandments of their own religions. No religion, if it's a good religion, will ever advocate violence. So we have to be careful that, yes, these people who have done these crimes, okay, they are sinners, but they are still Muslim. Just as any Christian who decides to kill 6 million Jews, still a Christian.
I mean, talking of Aqidah-wise, a newborn child to a non-Muslim, what is his immediate faith, I mean, Aqidah or what? What we will call it.
A newborn Muslim to who?
To a non-Muslim. Newborn child to a non-Muslim. So immediately what he is, Can we
call well, those are the details of the Aqidah. We'll discuss that some other time, inshallah. We're trying to establish the framework. So in principle, that person has no faith until he or she decides what to become. In reality, he is or she is born Muslim. That's different.
At the born Muslim.
Any other questions before we go on? Anybody's clear? So I want to conclude this session by discussing more about the role of the prophets in determining what is Aqidah and the role of the Sahaba in preserving the Aqidah and the role of the people who came after them in documenting the Aqidah in this kind of historical, chronological sense. So who identifies the Aqidah for us? Rasulullah receives wahi from Allah and he says, this is what Allah wants you to believe in, this is what Allah subhanahu wants you to do. So you have now your Aqidah and your behavior, your action. Both are determined by the institution of Rasulullah. So that is a given for every Muslim. And he is the one who is going to understand wahi more than anyone else. And the Sahaba received that wahi from Rasulullah. So without going into the details of usul hadith and usul sharia and everything else, and that for the Sahaba, the words of the Prophet were divine when it came to Islam. Okay? The words of the Prophet were divine when it came to understanding Islam and practicing Islam. In the minds of the Sahaba, there was no difference between wahi that came as the Quran and wahi that came as the Sunnah. So they would not differentiate because it was all wahi, revelation. This is what Allah wants us to do, and who's telling us this? Rasulullah. This is how Allah subhanahu wants us to believe, and who is telling us this? Rasulullah. Whether it's the Quran, or whether it's the Rasul's actions, or whether his confirmation, or his denials, approvals, and his acquiescence. So for the Sahaba, everything that was being came through wahi, which comes from another world. So they would preserve the deen the way they understood it from the Prophet ﷺ. And that is why, even during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, Sahaba would ask each other, what did the Prophet ﷺ say about this, and what did he say about this? Okay? The Sahaba did not always go to the Prophet ﷺ directly, because that was difficult, if not impossible, to do all the time. Muslims sometimes romanticize about the idea that they were all of a sudden, mashallah, 10,000 every day gathered around the person of the Prophet ﷺ and doing this and that. How did they sustain their lives? Right? So Umar radiallahu ta'ala who says that the Prophet ﷺ had made me a brother of this Ansar who had a farm which was a distance away from the Masjid al-Aqsa. So now, what does that mean? That means that the Prophet ﷺ did not want Muslims to feel obligated that they had to live right next door to him in order to understand Islam, because this was the process of developing a community, developing an ummah, developing a society. And how does one do that? That one cannot do this if you don't allow people to live and to earn a living. So he sent him with this Ansari brother all the way outskirts of Medina, but they had a farm. So Omar said to his Ansari brother that one day I will work in the farm and you will go and spend time with the Prophet ﷺ, and then when you come back in the evening, you will teach me everything you heard from him. You will teach me everything you heard from him. And then the next day, I will go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then when I come back, I will teach you everything I heard from him. What does this show you? This shows you that even during the time of the Prophet ﷺ, the Sahaba would learn from each other, even though Rasulullah ﷺ was right there. It's quite amazing and very brilliant and very ingenious that you're not going to impose the whole Ummah to say that I heard this from the Prophet ﷺ, because everything they heard and they said and they did was already endorsed by Rasulullah. Now, if Omar said to the Sahabi, I don't believe you, then what would have done? What would have that done? That would have what? Created disunity, disrespect, okay, and suspicion in the whole community. So the Sahaba are a bit more civilized than that. I don't believe you. I don't think you got this right. Let me go and ask him myself. There's no instance, except perhaps one or two, and that too for the sake of the Ummah, where you find any such kind of doubt. There's no doubt in what Rasulullah said or did. So they would do this. Very natural way, and a very sophisticated way, very civilized way. So during the time of the Prophet, the Sahaba would learn from each other about the deen, about the Sunnah, about the Quran, and so on. So if a certain Sahabi had memorized now one surah, that Sahabi did not feel compelled to go and memorize the surah from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly. He would sit down with his brother and say, teach me the surah. Right? In this context, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمُ الْقُرْآنُ وَعَلَّمَهُ. The best amongst you is the one who learns the Qur'an and then
teaches.
Now who is he saying this to? To his companions. Did he say, you must learn the Qur'an from me only? No. So what was the objective there? The objective there was to ascertain certainty, ascertain conclusiveness, that this is certainly wahi, this is conclusively wahi. There can be no doubt that when my Sahabi brother tells me this is the way Rasulullah ﷺ recited Surah Fatiha, then I know that this is the way he did so. This is absolute, this is certainty, this is wahi. And if my Sahabi brother says to me that this is the way the Prophet ﷺ showed us how to give the adhan, or how to do this and how to do that, then they maintained certainty. And this is very important, because nowadays people are always questioning each other. I don't believe you. Certain scholars said this, I don't believe you. So meaning that this humanness came into the Sahaba, that you do not doubt your brother for no reason. Why would he lie about Rasulullah? He's right there. So the Sahaba had this luxury of now saying that anything that Rasulullah said and did as part of Islam was wahi. So this is how they understood wahi from the Prophet, and they were the ones who preserved the meaning of wahi. They are the ones who preserved the meaning of wahi. This is what wahi is, and this is the meaning of wahi. As now Islam spread into different areas of the world, after the Prophet ﷺ left this world, then there was a need now to further preserve and cement and crystallize the deen, where Umar radiallahu anhu started to establish institutions. Umar radiallahu anhu did what? He started Islamic institutions. Kufa, for instance, is a city, a metropolis that Omar founded. Omar founded Kufa out there in Iraq. Omar radiallahu anhu said that Kufa is a place where Muslims are going, and Iraq is a place where Muslims are winning, and we will need to establish the deen in Kufa. So he founded Kufa, and he sent Abu Musa al-Shari, and he sent Abdullah ibn Masud radiallahu anhu to now teach the deen to the people of Kufa. And then within 20 years, 30 years, Kufa became an academic giant. It attracted so many people from so many different parts of the Khilafah, of the Ummah, and you found many great scholars there, to the degree that Ali radiallahu anhu moved his capital from Medina to Kufa. Now why would you do that? Why would you move your capital from Medina to Kufa if Kufa was not already established as what? A center of deen. A center of deen. Now you see that when it comes to policy, okay, you can now relax a bit. Because Kufa is a place where many, many scholars were born. Iraq is a place where many great scholars were born. And Hanifa came at the tail end of these great scholars, and he was from Kufa. Okay. So we see this, who preserved the deen? The Sahaba. And then who took the deen from the Sahaba? The Tabi'un. Today we speak about great Muslim intellectual giants. Okay. We'll speak about Ibn Khaldun, and we'll speak about Ghazali, and we'll speak about Ibn Hajar, and we'll speak about Ibn Taymiyyah, and we'll speak about everybody else except who? The Tabi'una, the Sahaba. The Tabi'una, who? The Sahaba. We'll speak about Imam Bukhari. We'll talk about everybody except the early Muslim scholars who were the reason why these scholars became brilliant. If I was to ask you, mashallah, I would embarrass you. That write down for me on a piece of paper the names of 10 tabi'in. You might be struggling and you're scratching your head. If I was to ask you, write down 10 Muslim scholars that you know of, no problem. Not 10, I'll give you 40. Why? Because now the emphasis has been on reading scholars who came after the tabi'in. Whereas in the early days of Islam, during the time of Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, and Shafi'i, Imam Ahmad, when Islam was being written and recorded and documented, they knew of these scholars because they were their teachers. So just because a scholar did not write, doesn't mean to say he's not a scholar. Right? Who were their writers? The scholars who wrote afterwards. Abu Hanifa wrote one book, two books, one on Aqidah, one on something else. But who were his scribes, his students? Abu Yusuf, Imam Muhammad. And they wrote. So just because Abu Hanifa didn't write doesn't mean to say that he was not a scholar of caliber. So now what is now the bid'ah of the time? That unless you have scholarship that is written and documented, you should not listen to that person. So you've killed the oral tradition. You've killed the essence of Islam. You've killed the human tradition and the human chain. There's a difference between someone who is seasoned and someone who has read one or two books. So now the preservation of deen was the responsibility of the Sahaba. Then the documentation and the recording of deen was now the responsibility of the Tabi'un and those who came afterwards. So in this sense, we have now this effort at Dar al-Qasim in Chicago to revive the oral tradition. And reviving the oral tradition means appreciating that everything that is recorded about Islam came from generations before them. And those generations did not necessarily write. They just were. They were. They existed. And because they were and they existed, they produced scholars. Just as Rasulullah did not read or write. Is that true?
Yes, yeah.
Have you ever thought of this? Rasulullah neither read nor wrote. He's a Nabi Ummi. The unlettered Nabi. So now the unlettered Nabi, how does he produce this civilization that then started to write? Where you have thousands of books in Qurtuba, hundreds of thousands of books in Baghdad, hundreds of thousands of books in Egypt, hundreds of thousands of books now in India, all about Islam. But that came from which source? From al-Nabi al-Ummi, and that is the mu'jiza. What is the mu'jiza? The mu'jiza is that the written tradition comes from what? The oral tradition. That is the mu'jiza of Islam. That before you say to somebody, show me the proof where it's written that Maghrib is three rakats in the Quran, you say, you think we're idiots? We have lived this religion. This religion existed in the human civilization, not in books. The modern day Muslim wants to see Islam where? In the books. That is a bid'ah. That is a bid'ah. The greatest bid'ah.
Could you repeat that, please?
Yeah. The modern day Muslim wants to see Islam in the books. Where the early Muslims wanted to see Islam where? In the community, in the Ummah. So the only time they question the Ummah and the community is when the scholars raise an issue, this maybe not be the best for the Ummah or the civilization. So there was no doubt, and there was goodwill, and there was good feeling. So now this brings about the social ethics of a civilization. We lack social ethics. We don't trust anyone who talks to us about Islam that is based on the oral tradition. We want people to show us where? The book. So why is Islam in the book? Islam is not in the book. It is in Rasulullah ﷺ, who is a Nabi of Ummi. So the Sahaba, when they went to Rasulullah ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, you say Al-Fatiha is now wahi. Did they say, show me the book? Well, he didn't read it right. How is he going to show you a book? The Tabi'un, when they heard from the Sahaba, this is what Rasulullah said and did. Did the Tabi'un say, show me the book? They were the book. Right. So now this bid'ah of trying to now document and footnote and reference everything that is Islamic, that is a bid'ah. Meaning you've killed Islam. Mm. You have destroyed Islam from within. That doesn't mean to say we didn't write. Imam Ghazali, exceptional writer, a beautiful writer. You had writers who wrote on the esoteric, and you had writers who wrote on law, and you had writers who wrote on poetry, and they composed poetry, and you had writers who wrote on balagha and rhetoric and adab and grammar, and you had writers who wrote on every Islamic discipline. But their discipline came from the oral tradition, not from the written tradition. Now, ironically, as history would and fate would have it, the only way we, unfortunately, can access the oral tradition is through what? Through the books. Or through the shuyukh, who come to you and sit with you and say, this is Islam, this is not Islam. One of two ways. So we have now two efforts. One is to promote the shuyukh, the living shuyukh who know Islam inside out, and upside down, every which way, and say, sit with this man, he will teach you what Islam is, and you can live Islam by being with him. Or the other way is to develop and form institutions that help Muslims read the oral tradition. There's two ways. There's no third way. There's no third way. This is the effort that needs to be done. So when we are talking about Aqidah, we must speak about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's humanness, and as a human being, he was a Nabi al-Ummi. He was the unlettered prophet, where he didn't read or write. The Sahaba, the Khulafa Rashidun, they all wrote. Abu Bakr, he wrote. Umar, he wrote. Uthman, he wrote. And Ali, obviously, was the genius writer. Right. So they all wrote. But they never question who? An-Nabiyul Ummi. So their appreciation for knowledge was based on their aqidah, not on what was visible. So is it Iman al-Ghayb? Is Iman what? Al-Ghayb. Likewise, the appreciation of the Tabi'een for Rasulullah was based on the word of the Sahabi. So they never questioned the integrity of the Sahabi, because this is not the social ethics, that you trust each other. So the Rasulullah said, one hadith for instance, that dhunnu bil mu'minina khayra, have a good opinion about believers. Have a good opinion about believers. So don't mistrust each other. So now the issue of trust now comes in. So the ulama of hadith say that when it comes to a sahabi, we will never question any sahabi's integrity. A sahaba kulluhum adul. Every sahabi is what? He is so honest and disciplined that whenever he speaks about wahi, he will be honest. We as Muslims cannot question the integrity of a sahabi. That is our aqidah. That is what? Our aqidah. This is called the aqidah of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the aqidah of the Sunnis. That the Sunnis believe that when it came to representing and disseminating wahi, the sahaba were individually and collectively trustworthy. We don't question that. After the sahaba, we will look into the lives of everybody, the tabi'in. And we will then say, this tabi'i, did he spend time with the sahaba? Was he known for his piety? Was he known for his scholarship? Did people know him or did people not know him? So if there's an unknown person who says that a sahabi said this, then the scholars later on would say, we don't know enough about this person to verify whether he was trustworthy or not. Therefore, there will be a weakness in the chain of narrators, and that will create a weak hadith or weak sanad in the hadith. So that's how we got this. So now, what was the premise for preserving the deen? The premise for preserving the deen was the integrity and the honesty of every sahabi. Does that make sense? So we preserve the deen, meaning the sahaba preserve the deen because of the integrity and the honesty. Then scholars later on, they analyzed each statement and they said this is now part of Islam because this is what the ummah lived. And this is now acceptable in Islam because this is what the Ummah accepted, and this is not acceptable because this is what the Ummah did not accept. And that's how you got your historical Islam after the Tabi'un. Right? That is how we do Aqidah also. So now, in matters of Aqidah, whatever the Sahaba understood is Islamic Aqidah, is Islamic Aqidah. And whatever the Sahaba rejected as un-Islamic, it is rejected still. That is called primary level aqidah. Primary level aqidah. So in these primary matters, the Sahaba now preserve the deen, and Islam remains monolithic in theology. In what? In theology. Not in practice. Not in fiqh. Not in fiqh. We're discussing what's the difference between religion and the deen. So religion and deen means what is your faith, what is your belief system. So every Muslim adhere to the same belief system in matters of najat and salvation. Every Muslim did not necessarily practice the same. There were details in which they differed. There are details in which they differed, as long as those details were not contradictory to the monolithic Islam. So nobody came up with this idea that since fasting in summer is so difficult, we must now make Islam easy, so let's all fast when? In December. Nobody conceived of this idea, ever. Now what?
Well, I was about to say,
I mean, within the Muslim community. Within the Muslim community.
Between Christmas and New Year's.
Yeah, mashallah. But You understand my point?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah?
Clear.
That when it was now conclusively Islamic, then we didn't mess with it. What was inconclusive, we debated. So debate is allowed where there is inconclusive evidence about an issue. And who's going to decide that? It won't be Sheikh Google. Yeah? It'll be the people who have training in this field, in this science. They're experts, and that's the way Islam has always been. So that monolithic Islam is where the Aqidah is monolithic, and the practice is monolithic. And where pluralism is allowed, we were pluralistic. We allowed a difference of opinion in so many issues of Salat, of Sawm and Zakat and Hajj, that if you were to scan just the differences, you'll find that in matters of Salat, there are 30,000 issues in which we differ. How many? 30,000. So now the modern day Muslim will say, why are you different about Salat? So, take it easy. It's okay. It's okay. Put your hand here.
Yeah.
The Sahaba tolerated it. We should tolerate it. Is there one way? There is one way of the skeleton of Salat, and there are other ways to do the whole Salat. So it's no big deal. You're all going to Jannah, inshallah. That's where you're going, right? Now, if you make it a fight, then you're not going to Jannah. You're going somewhere else. Because fighting is haram. But tolerating differences, allowed. In fact, celebrated. Two Sahabi came to the masjid at a time for Salat al-Fajr. One Sahabi, he saw that the Jamaat had started, and he joined the Imam. He joined the Imam. And he didn't do his Sunnah. The other Sahabi said that, I have time to do my Sunnah, so I'll do my Sunnah first, then I'll join the Jamaat. And they both came out of the masjid shaking each other's hands, MashaAllah, Alhamdulillah, how are you? I'm fine. They didn't say, bid'ah, haram. Meaning this social ethic, okay, is so crucial to the survival of this ummah that that social ethic only comes in the company of a sheikh. Only comes where? In the company of a sheikh. A sheikh who says, somebody wants to come here and he's confrontational, I'll accept, it's fine, no problem. So we're going to diffuse the confrontation by saying, it's okay, relax, come down, have some tea, have some coffee. We're not going to condemn you for having this confrontational approach to deen. Just relax. And the other way is that when there are differences, and those differences must be highlighted, expressed where? In the written tradition, that these are differences of opinion. And we tolerate them, and we, in fact, celebrate them. So this will be, inshallah, our first session. And based on this session, we'll continue after a while, inshallah. So if you have questions, we may end with those questions.
The issue of trust came up. What is the basis, Islamic basis, for us to establish this trust that you're speaking about? Because I'm listening to what you're saying in terms of the oral tradition and being able to trust the person that's delivering, you know, the information. You know, how do we establish that? I guess how do we determine that?
Yes,
based
that,
on
that's a very good question, very relevant. When you're listening to a khatib, for instance, on Jum'ah, and he's saying something, then do you take everything he says on face value, or do you investigate or explore, or do you inquire? Or if somebody comes from out of town, he says something, then how do you take that from him? So that is where talabul ilm, seeking knowledge, becomes fard on every Muslim. So for every Muslim must know his fard ayn, and understand that if I don't know my fard ayn, then the onus is on me, not on the speaker. What is fard ayn? Fard ayn is that knowledge which is necessary for najat and salvation. What do I need to know about tawheed, about akhirah, about risala? What do I need to know about sawm, salat, zakat, and hajj? so that if anyone comes to me and says, this is what Allah wants you to do, then I know, no. This is not part of the Fard Ayn, you can't say that. Yeah? So we must be willing to take the next step, some of us. Muslims, I'm sure, know the Fard Ayn very well, mashallah. But at least to have a comprehensive discussion on what is Fard Ayn. Understand that this is what Allah and His Rasul and Sahaba did collectively. This is monolithic. So the monolithic Islam must be the prerogative and the priority of every Muslim to learn. Okay. With the assistance of books or people, shaykh or whoever. So that that person who now is issuing a statement that is un-Islamic, anti-Islamic, you may be able to decipher very quickly that this is right and this is wrong. And that's how the Ummah used to be. The Ummah used to be that the beauty of the earlier, mashallah, communities was that everybody was at an academic level. So in the time of the Sahaba, the Tabi'un, everybody else, that was mind-boggling. Even though they didn't read or write, everybody knew Fard Ayn. You could not mess with any Muslim's iman or aqidah or practice. So this is unheard of. That nowadays, when people come up with ideas about what is Islam, what is not Islam, then they say, well, we should question the shuyukh, and we should question the ulama, and we should question their references and sources, etc. Not knowing, understanding that the brilliance of Imam Ghazali was because the whole community was brilliant. Right? That makes sense?
Yeah.
So when you're presenting a paper in a symposium or in a seminar that has a very high academic level of, shall we say, intellectual discourse. Tony Blair went to a lecture on astronomy in London, right? And the people who organized the lecture on astronomy said, you won't understand a word, so you shouldn't be there. He said, but I'm the Prime Minister, so you don't care. So he went and he said, I didn't understand a word. So nowadays we have diluted Islam so much that the layperson, very kind of atrociously, is asking the scholar, is this a weak hadith? Allah, for the life of me, who are you to understand what is weak and what is not weak? The weak hadith was the prerogative of a muhaddith who understood the chain of narrators and went through the mill of studying hadith for 10, 15 years. You don't have that prerogative, any more than you'd understand astronomy, or physics, or E equals MC squared. And you can quote it, you won't know what it means. Right? So I'm simply asking, is this a weak hadith? What do you mean by a weak hadith? But then someone says it's a weak hadith, who is that someone? Well, maybe the hadith is not weak as you are. See, we have to be careful that you do not ghettoize Islamic knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
Which is what's happening. Islamic knowledge has become ghettoized. Now it is in the dirts, okay, and in the ghettos of streets. That every Muslim is now asking, is this a weak hadith? I mean, the idea that hadith will be weak is inconceivable in the mind of Muslims. That's why I said the Sahaba, when they heard the Prophet ﷺ, they didn't say this weak hadith, or this wahi, this not wahi, or this Quran, or this hadith. They were there, they were with it. So now what has happened is that the Ummah has suffered from tremendous ignorance. And you want to now implant an academic standard on this ignorance. That's what happened. So we need to re-culture, and we need to redevelop, and we need to reintroduce academic scholarship so that the bar of education is higher, and that the lay person who is not in that field is not able to ask the question. Right. That is not your prerogative. What is your prerogative? Your prerogative is to know what is called the ayn, what is necessary for your najat, and so on and so forth. Your prerogative is not to ask everybody, where is this mentioned, where is it recorded, where is it documented? But now, no doubt, having said that, there will be people who claim to be scholars, but they have different ideas, and that is where your question is. Okay? How do you ascertain that trust?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So ascertaining that trust requires, in civilization, institutions of knowledge. Unless you have quantifiable, objective standards of knowledge, you will not create that trust. If somebody comes to you today and says that this person is a graduate from Harvard and he's going to talk to you about microbiology, will you now trust him or will you not trust him?
Trust.
Why?
Just because he graduated from Harvard?
I rest my case. Since Muslims of the 20th century did not establish institutions of higher learning and higher levels of academic study and rigor, nobody trusts anyone. There's no authority left. So the authority is a layperson on the street. So that's the demise of the Muslim, because they do not recognize scholarship. So in the past, the beauty was that everybody recognized scholarship. I know my fardain. If I want some more information on this ayah, this tafsir, then I will not go to the books, because the books are written for those who wrote the books, not for the layperson. Somebody came up to a scholar, mashallah, in Pakistan and said, "Yeah, Shaykh, you know, I'm reading Iqbab, I don't understand anything." He said, "You fool, he didn't write it for you." Allama Iqbab didn't write for you. He wrote for those whom he wrote for. He has a market. He has an audience. He didn't write for the layperson. If some of those poems are great and the layperson appreciates them, that's fine. There's no doubt in that. So scholarship must be maintained at a level of scholarship. That's when you raise the level of awareness in the community. If the level of awareness in the community is now below zero, then the level of scholarship is going to drop. So the Prophet's mission was to raise the level of scholarship amongst the ummah, and that's what the Sahaba did, and that's what Tabi'in did.
And that is still the mission.
That's still the mission.